Good morning, everyone. My name is Kristie Shipley. I'm with the Division of Environmental Response and Revitalization Hazardous Waste Program. Thank you for joining us today for a brief webinar on the sewer disposal prohibition section of the new federal hazardous waste pharmaceutical rule. The purpose of this webinar is to provide information specific to the sewer ban section of the new rule because it goes into effect this month. We anticipate adopting the full federal rule in spring of next year, so we'll have an additional webinar as that time approaches and we'll go in more depth. This morning, we'll introduce you to the rule, provide some background information to help you understand the rationale behind the sewer ban, discuss who is subject to the rule, and how you should manage your hazardous waste pharmaceuticals going forward. As Helen said, we'll have time at the end to answer questions, so feel free to submit them anytime. On February 22nd of this year, the US EPA published the final rule titled Management Standards for Hazardous Waste Pharmaceuticals and Amendment to the P75 Listing for Nicotine. The sewer prohibition section will become effective in all states on August 21st. This means hazardous waste pharmaceuticals can no longer be disposed by drain, whether that's flushing down the toilet or pouring down the sink or into a floor drain. Just to give you a little bit of background information, currently domestic sewage is excluded from the Resource Conservation and Recovery Act, or RCRA, which regulates hazardous waste. This means any mixture of domestic sewage and other waste that passes through a sewer system to a publicly owned treatment works, or POTW, is not considered a solid waste, and therefore it's not regulated as a hazardous waste. This is why, up to this point, RCRA hasn't prohibited drain disposal of waste. That type of activity has been regulated under the Clean Water Act, which already prohibits the discharge of pollutants that create a fire or explosion hazard or that result in toxic gases, vapors, or fumes within the POTW. From a hazardous waste standpoint, that would mean wastes that are ignitable and some that are reactive and corrosive are already prohibited from being sewered. The hazardous and solid waste amendments that were passed in 1984 left the door open for RCRA to be revised in respect to the domestic sewage exclusion. When it's been determined that waste constituents are not regulated sufficiently under the existing federal rules to protect human health and the environment, requirements that are developed under this authority become effective in all states on the effective date of the federal regulation, which is why the sewer ban becomes effective in August prior to Ohio EPA adopting the full rule. Currently, there are no pollutant discharge limits that apply to healthcare facilities who discharge pharmaceuticals to POTWs, and traditional wastewater treatment systems are designed to remove conventional pollutants such as suspended solids, biodegradable organic compounds, not pharmaceuticals, which means they're passing through untreated to surface water and they're having a negative impact on aquatic ecosystems. EPA's final rule will reduce the risk caused by hazardous waste pharmaceuticals that enter the environment through flushing. The sewer ban is projected to prevent the flushing of approximately 2,000 tons of hazardous waste pharmaceuticals a year. This rule is specific to healthcare facilities that generate, accumulate, or otherwise handle hazardous waste pharmaceuticals, as well as reverse distributors who are engaged in the management of prescription hazardous waste pharmaceuticals for manufacturer credit. It's important to note that even conditionally exempt small quantity generators who typically aren't required to follow the more stringent hazardous waste rules are subject to the sewer ban. So in order to fully understand who's subject to this rule, we need to go over some definitions. A healthcare facility is defined by the federal rule in two parts. First, it's defined as any person that is lawfully authorized to provide preventative, diagnostic, therapeutic, rehabilitative, maintenance, or palliative care, and counseling, service, assessment, or procedure with respect to the physical or mental condition or functional status of a human or animal, or that affects the structure or function of the human or animal body, or a person who is authorized to distribute, sell, or dispense pharmaceuticals, including over-the-counter or prescription pharmaceuticals, as well as dietary supplements and homeopathic drugs. Healthcare facilities include, but are not limited to, hospitals, doctor's offices, ambulance services, psychiatric hospitals, optical and dental providers, traditional long-term care and mail order pharmacies, surgical centers, chiropractors, retailers of over-the-counter meds, health clinics, long-term care facilities, and veterinary clinics and hospitals. So in addition to a healthcare facility, this rule is applicable to a reverse distributor, which is defined as any person that receives and accumulates prescription pharmaceuticals that are potentially credible hazardous waste pharmaceuticals for the purpose of facilitating or verifying manufacturer credit. In our final definition, a pharmaceutical is broadly defined as any drug or dietary supplement for use by humans or animals, and any liquid nicotine for retail use, as well as electronic nicotine delivery systems, so e-cigarettes and vape pens. Pharmaceuticals include things such as dietary supplements and homeopathic drugs, both prescription and over-the-counter drugs, compounded and investigational drugs, pharmaceuticals that remain in containers, personal protective equipment that has become contaminated with pharmaceuticals, as well as cleanup material from pharmaceutical spills. Dental amalgam and sharps are not considered pharmaceuticals. A pharmaceutical can be hazardous if it belongs to either the P or U list. These two lists are for pure and commercial grade formulations of unused chemicals. This means the pharmaceutical or its sole active ingredient belong to the list. The P list is for acutely hazardous waste, and the U list is for discarded chemical products that are a hazardous waste. Now, there are approximately 30 chemicals between these lists that have pharmaceutical uses. A pharmaceutical could also be a hazardous waste if it exhibits a hazardous characteristic, meaning it's ignitable, corrosive, or toxic. There are several drugs that are both DEA controlled substances and hazardous waste. This table shows the ones that have overlap between the two regulations. As I mentioned earlier, the Clean Water Act already prohibits drain disposal of anything ignitable. So really the only new controlled substance impacted by the sewer ban is chlorohydrate, which is a sedative and a U-listed hazardous waste. It's been common practice to waste unused medicine in the sink or toilet to render it non-retrievable, but this needs to cease specifically for hazardous waste pharmaceuticals beginning August 21st. To recap, in order to determine if you're subject to this rule, if you meet the definition of a healthcare facility or reverse distributor and you're generating pharmaceutical waste that is also a hazardous waste, you are subject to the rule. And any hazardous waste pharmaceutical that you may have previously disposed by drain needs to be managed differently going forward. Before the full rule is adopted, which will be streamlined to better fit the healthcare industry, you'll need to manage your hazardous waste pharmaceuticals under existing Ohio hazardous waste rules. Your specific requirements will be dependent on your generator status, which is determined by how much hazardous waste or acute hazardous waste you generate in a one-month time period. You can see here it's separated into three different categories. And please note that any pharmaceutical that belongs to the P list is acutely toxic and needs to be counted separately from your other hazardous waste in order to determine your generator category. Over the next few slides, I'm going to give general overview of the current management methods, specifically for small and large quantity generators, since conditionally exempt small quantity generators aren't subject to as many requirements. However, they're still responsible for evaluating their hazardous waste and ensuring proper disposal. Small quantity and large quantity generators have requirements for managing satellite accumulation areas, which need to be at or near the point of generation. This is most likely going to be in your pharmacy or in your nurse's station. You're limited to 55 gallons of non-acute hazardous waste and 1 quart of acute hazardous waste per satellite area. Containers must be in good condition, compatible with the waste that's being stored, labeled as hazardous waste, and marked with an accumulation start date when the container becomes full. There are also requirements to maintain proper aisle space and conduct weekly inspections of the storage areas. Training must be conducted so that employees understand how to properly handle hazardous waste and how to respond to an emergency. Emergency equipment should consist of an internal communication system, a telephone or two-way radio that is accessible to employees who are entering areas where hazardous waste is stored, as well as fire, spill control, and decontamination equipment capable of controlling the types of hazardous waste that's stored. Small quantity generators are limited to storing hazardous waste on site for 180 days, and large quantity generators are limited to 90 days. Small quantity generators must have someone designated to coordinate emergency response activities, while large quantity generators must have a full written contingency plan on site. You must determine if your hazardous waste needs to be treated before it can be landfilled. A one-time written notice has to be sent to the treatment storage disposal facility that receives your hazardous waste. Only large quantity generators are required to submit a biennial report, which is due March 1st of even-numbered years and covers the hazardous waste that was shipped in the previous year. Records must be kept on site for 3 years. These records include waste evaluations or profiles, manifests, land disposal restriction notifications, training records, biennial reports, and exception reports. These are the reports that you submit to Ohio EPA if you don't receive a signed manifest back from the treatment storage disposal facility in the appropriate time frame. And just to clarify, because I think this might be a common practice in healthcare facilities, hazardous waste pharmaceuticals cannot be placed in the biohazardous waste red sharp bins. Biohazardous waste is typically sterilized in an autoclave prior to being disposed in a landfill, and the temperature achieved during autoclaving isn't hot enough to destroy most pharmaceutical ingredients. And also during sterilization, there's the possibility for wastewater to be generated that's contaminated with pharmaceuticals, and that could be discharged to the sewer. Instead, hazardous waste pharmaceuticals should be disposed of at a hazardous waste incinerator or in a hazardous waste landfill after it's been treated under the land disposal restrictions program. To summarize, beginning August 21st, hazardous waste pharmaceuticals can no longer be put down the drain or flushed down the toilet, and the Ohio EPA strongly discourages sewering of any pharmaceutical. I'm going to open it up for questions. If you don't feel comfortable submitting a question through the webinar or reaching out to me directly, you can always remain anonymous and call the compliance assistance hotline number that's listed on this slide.
When does Ohio EPA anticipate adopting the generator improvements rule?
We anticipate adopting that March of 2020, and the pharmaceutical rule will be included in that package.
Okay, do weekly inspections also apply to satellite accumulation areas?
No, they do not.
How does this apply to over-the-counter products in healthcare facilities that contain things like selenium,
like multivitamins?
So multivitamins are considered a pharmaceutical, but we still need to determine whether or not it's a hazardous waste pharmaceutical.
Okay. Another question on, do pharmaceuticals include items like Pepto-Bismol that would be allowed to go down the drain?
Yes.
Okay. Can you put up the slide that determines the generator category a healthcare facility falls in?
Okay, so this is a slide that shows the generator categories depending on how much you're generating in a one-month period.
Okay, does this apply to nitroglycerin-containing products?
Yes, it does.
We're back for some more questions. What is the difference of what is required for compliance for the 8/21/19 date and the spring of 2020 date?
So the 8/21 date, the only thing that you need to be complying with is the sewer ban of disposing of any hazardous waste pharmaceutical by drain. And spring 2020, that's when we anticipate adopting the full federal rule.
Are research facilities included in this rule?
No, not unless you're meeting the definition of a healthcare facility or reverse distributor.
For FQG, how often do we need to determine if we meet the criteria? Is it ongoing or once a year?
Ongoing.
No controlled substances should be flushed or put down the drain, correct?
So I think I need to emphasize here that what we're banning on August 21st is hazardous waste pharmaceuticals. So the ones that are overlapping with the controlled substances that are hazardous waste, that's what we're talking about.
Are assisted living facilities considered long-term care if a nurse passes medications?
No, assisted living facilities are not considered long-term care facilities for this rule.
How do you envision the compliance side of this being conducted?
So Ohio EPA isn't adopting the full rule until March. So from a compliance inspection standpoint, we're not enforcing it until that time, but that doesn't mean the US EPA can't come in and enforce it.
For SQG, can systems like Drug Buster or Prescription Destroyer be used for hazardous control substances like fentanyl?
No, we don't recommend putting hazardous waste into those devices.
Can plain IV fluids still be emptied down the sink?
That's going to be dependent on the POTW. So anytime you're discharging anything down the drain, you need to contact the POTW to get approval.
Is there a particular place to order compliant pharmaceutical waste containers for disposal?
No.
I didn't catch what was said about the systems like the cactus
and prescription destroyer. Can hazardous controlled substances
go in these if the canisters then go out as hazardous waste?
We recommend not putting anything that is a hazardous waste into these devices.
How should you dispose of hazardous controlled substances if systems like cactus cannot be used?
So if the controlled substance is a hazardous waste, it needs to be disposed of at a permitted facility.
Okay, that is all of our questions today, and we know that we did not answer everyone's questions. Some of them are very specific questions, and Kristie will follow up with you. She'll get the email list, and if you have your phone number, she'll either follow up with a phone call or email. And that's it. Just checking on the questions. Okay. Well, we would really appreciate you taking a minute to complete our evaluation. We're always looking for ways to improve our webinars, and we hope that you found the information very helpful today. And again, if you have very specific questions on the new rule, please contact Kristie. Let's put up that final contact slide again with your information. There we go. And again, the 800 number is also available to you to ask questions on this particular rule.